So when God asks us to do something, to change something, says, if you profess a faith in me, then you have got to change. I will help you to change because I know what is best for you. The greatest promise is that actually God doesn't leave us alone. Doesn't leave us hanging out to dry. Doesn't say, here you go deal with it. That's why Jesus died on the cross, was it not? It was to break that power that sin had over us. So that we can actually choose not to do something. We actually have got the ability, because of what Jesus did on the cross, and because God doesn't leave us out to hang out to dry, and because we've got the Holy Spirit living within us, we have the ability to do that. But it's by faith, and we have to believe that.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
Lord, we thank you so far that you've been present among us this morning. Thank you that we are able to worship you in freedom and in love. Thank you, Lord. It's not about how we feel, but it's just about how we should just be worshipping you, the one true living God. Pray now, Lord, that as we all just settle down and we want to listen to your word, Lord, that we will listen to you and what you have to say through the Spirit into our lives. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, if you'd just like to watch this clip. Thank you, Barry. You don't fix faith, it fixes you. Sorry, right at the beginning of that scene, Shepherd Book, who is the gentleman that walks in, I think it's an interesting name, Shepherd Book. He just sort of walks in and says, what are you doing, sweetheart? And River turns around and says, I'm fixing your Bible. Now, I don't agree with all everything that show says, but it is something about faith, and that's what I want us to discuss, is faith. The faith in which we profess if we are followers of Jesus Christ, and what that means for our lives on a daily basis. Could you turn with me, please, to Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 to 3. Now, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command. I want to talk about just faith. I just want to define part of the word faith. I think we'd be here for the next week if we try to really sort of come out with every definition possibly surrounding faith and what that means. So I'm not going to make an exhaustive list this morning of defining faith. One comment I read about faith. Faith is an assured knowledge that changes the believer. Every time I'm talking about faith this morning, I am talking about faith in Jesus Christ, to God the Father. Okay, I'm not talking about any other faith. Every time I mention faith, that is what I'm talking about. Okay, everybody with me on that one? The following in this book of Hebrews, problem is with sectioning off, you know, things in chapters, etc. You sort of miss the flow sometimes of the letter. When we get to chapter 11 as such, he's actually spent, the author, who really is debatable, is actually flowed through the whole of this book in this letter. It sort of is talking about why there is this faith and why they have this belief. And it sort of flowed. I just want to go back to chapter 10, verse 36. So just go up a few verses. And he's sort of closing off a little bit here with, you need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a very little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one will live by faith. And if he shrinks back, I will not be pleased with him. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who believe and are saved. We are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who believe and are saved. No doubt in the church here, there's been lots of persecution going on and lots of problems, and it is read in the early stuff. And what the author is here is asking them to persevere in faith in God. I hope we can all try and our best to consider ourselves not people to shrink back when persecution comes or when problems come our way. I would like to think like that. I know I've had moments. But let's just carry on defining this word faith. Faith in God, in Jesus, anticipates the future. Anticipates good things for the future. Those of us who believe in God and follow through Jesus have a hope, do we not? We should always be looking forward to this hope. It's an assurance of the things that are hoped for. Now, faith in God gives us a faith that we have got a heavenly home to go to. Yes? Yes? And we should have that sort of anticipation always going on with us. Anticipation that God is going to be working through our lives. Anticipation that God is always with us. Faith, in my mind, in part of that, is the knowledge of God and his promises. And because of those promises, we look at our present in light of what our future is going to be. Yeah? Let's look at some examples of that. We're going to carry on reading in Hebrews chapter 11. Never done this before, but I'm actually going to read that entire chapter. Because I think on its own, it says something. Everybody ready? I'm going to start at verse 1 again. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, and as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, Abraham, even though he was past age and Sarah herself was barren, was enabled to become a father because he considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so, from this one man, And he, as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on the earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. By faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had received the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son. Even though God had said to him, "It is through Isaac your offspring will be reckoned." Abraham reasoned that God would raise the dead, and figuratively speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of the Joseph's sons and worshipped as he leaned on the top of his staff. By faith, Joseph, when his end was near, spoke about the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt and gave instructions about his bones. By faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be ill-treated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a short time. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn of Israel. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land. But when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after the people had marched around them for 7 days. By faith, the prostitute Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Japheth, David, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. Others were tortured and refused to be released, so that they might gain a better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging, while others were chained and put in prison. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and ill-treated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. I want to resound a massive great amen after that. Because there is a running theme through that. Don't know if you noticed it, but it's by faith. But there is a running theme through that. And I've read that chapter numerous times this week, and every time it just lifted me, and I thought, yes, oh, wow, what they were able to do, what happened to these guys in their lives, because they had faith in God. Guys, by the way, I mean that as a multi-gender, women and males, clearly in there. And they're just the ones that are written about. They're the ones that are sort of famous, the ones that we all know about. In New Testament times, you know, talk later, there are loads of others, even in Old Testament times. People who are not spoken about, who had faith, though, in God. And they had faith in God. They in faith to do what God wanted them to do. They had an assured knowledge of God's good promises to them. So I just want to go through this again, this chapter. So I'm not going to reread it all again. But I just felt on its own, it's such an empowering passage. It shouldn't be isolated. It should be mixed in with the whole book of Hebrews. But, you know, for a read, and I really recommend anybody reading that this week, later on. Read it out loud. Verse 6 in chapter 11. Without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. It is impossible to believe, to please God without faith. And that is true. We can't please God with works. It is through faith initially. It's faith that he exists. But what I read about this whole passage and what got me was that if you read just some of the names like Abel or Enoch or Abraham, most certainly, and Noah, that they believed he existed, and with that knowledge, they depended upon God. They earnestly sought his goodwill every day through faith. That's why they are in this book as excellent examples of people that earnestly seek God through faith. And that's why they fulfilled promises that God, and that is why they had faith, because they knew they had to depend upon God daily. The question I have is, do we? Do we really depend upon God daily? And do we earnestly seek him? Because that's what faith in God is about. It's one of the reasons that faith in God is about. It is about seeking him because we believe in him. We believe in his promises and we believe that God is the only way through Jesus. As always, when I speak and preach and I ask difficult questions, and I ask good things as well, I am talking to myself. That's always one of the things I say. Verse 7. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. Always read the book of, when you read about Noah, I always sit there with this real, God comes down, says, all right, I've had enough of the world, Noah, I'm going to condemn it. Go build an ark. Go and build this big, oversized boat in your backyard, in front of all your neighbourhoods. Don't worry, you're going to probably look like a bit of a vanilla, but do it. His neighbours must have thought, what are you doing? Why are you doing this thing? And Noah probably said, well, God's told me to do so. But why? Why are you doing it? That's daft. You shouldn't be doing that, Noah. You're wasting your time. You're wasting all your energy and resources on something that can't be seen. But Noah had faith. He believed what God was saying was going to happen was going to happen. He also had faith that he knew he had to build this ark. He allowed his faith and his belief in God to not worry about what his neighbours were saying. He allowed it to change his lifestyle. I've only just remembered now. There's a movie, isn't there, that got done? Not Bruce Almighty, but the second version on from that. Evan Almighty, isn't it? Yeah. It's the same sort of image I've got when you see that. I don't know if you've seen the movie. Have you seen the movie? Yeah. So this politician, isn't he, in America? Obviously well-to-do, he's actually progressing through the ranks of politics. And then God, in this form of the actor Morgan Freeman, sort of comes down and says, you know, I want you to build an ark. Evan is his name. sort of says, you what, initially resists, but then starts realising he needs to. And he does it. And he's got his neighbours, his work colleagues, jeering him, saying he's lost the plot. What is up with him? But he carried on and he built it. And he turned out he was right. Because they're having a drought as well in the area, but he was right. Now, I know that's just a movie, but could you imagine maybe slightly part of that with Noah? Yet it was, he did it by faith. Probably the same for us, living as Christians. Our neighbours know that we're Christians, and maybe we resist doing things. We go to church Sunday morning. Why do you go to church Sunday morning? Well, I go to worship God. Well, he doesn't exist, does he? Can't see him, can't feel him, can't touch him. Well, yeah, he does. Because I got faith. All right. But how many of our neighbours probably look at us and just think we're a little bit daft? But we don't worry about that because we have faith in God. We have faith in God. We allow God to say what we need to do. Verses 8 to 19, I'm not going to reread them. It's all about Abraham. What can I say about Abraham? What can we say about Abraham? Probably the one commended the most. Now, there was a man of faith, yes? God says, get up, leave your comfort, leave your family, go. Okay, I'm off. There's no record of him there arguing. He was obedient and willing to do it by faith. God said, I'm going to give you a land. I'm going to take you to a land to show you how it's going to be inherited. By faith, Abraham said, fine, I will change my lifestyle of comfort and near my family and go and do what God asked me to do. By faith, he gets told, even though you're well advanced in years and so is your wife, you will have a son. God said this to him. Believed him. He tried to help out God. I grant you that, slightly. But when his own son came out, Sarah, he was like... And then God says to him, this one and only heir, I now want you to go and sacrifice. I want you to go and sacrifice everything that I have promised. You see, all the promises are in this one child. By this time, Isaac would have been a child. In this child, I want you to go and sacrifice. All the promises in the past, I want you to now, you know, are rooted in this one child. I want you to go and sacrifice. By faith, Abraham says, yes, God. Because he believed, probably deep down in his heart, that God is going to raise him from the dead. He's going to do and hang on the past promises that God has given him. Because he believed it to be true. Due to the faith that Abraham had in God, he saw the present circumstances in light of what he knew the future promises were going to be. Do we do the same? Who's got a future promise here that they know they are going to heaven because they have faith in Jesus? I want hands to stay up. But you know, it's one of those things. Just for a second. I think that's something we need to sometimes stand and say, yes, I have a future promise and I need to hold on to that, not go, yeah, I do. You can put them down now, it's okay. But we all say, yes, I have this faith. I believe in the promises that God has granted me. Yes? And we're meant to look at our present circumstances, no matter what they are, whether they be good or bad, in the light of that future. Yes? No matter what God says, I want you to do now. And you go, but that doesn't hold true for what might happen in the future. But if God is asking us to do something now, we have to hold on to the fact there is a promise and there is a reason for it. And we have to walk by. And that's what Abraham did. I'm not going to go through the... No, I won't do that. No. But if you look at what Abraham did, he actually said, as he was leaving the men to go off with just him and Isaac to go and sacrifice, he actually stated three times, he stated that we will be back to the men. He said, we will be back. You have to look into the book of Genesis, you have to look into the book of Genesis to look it up. But he said, we will be back. So he knew he was coming back with Isaac. That was a plural. It was only him and Isaac going off, and he got told he'd got to sacrifice his son. But he's stating to his men, we will be back. That's faith. That is faith at work. That is hanging on to promises that were given and granted and said, no matter how this looks like now, I know I've got a promise and I need to go with it. Go with what God and believe he knows what is best. And believe that God knows what he's doing. Living on the promises of God. How many of us actually do that? Live on the promises of God? I mean, really. We've got a promise of God of going to heaven. Yeah, once you've accepted Jesus into your life as your Lord and your Saviour and says, you are my Lord, we can live on those promises. But it has to be a daily, Lord, you are my God. Lord, today is your day. So right at the beginning of that whole list of those that live by faith was they earnestly seek God daily and God's will. And they just didn't make the prayer in this came. This was sort of pre-Jesus, but later in the New Testament. It wasn't like a one prayer and then going off and doing your own thing. It was a genuine belief that God knows what is best. And the same goes for us. We have to allow God every day to change our life and say it's yours. That doesn't have to be a radical change, you know. It doesn't have to be, right, now we'll leave your houses and go off to some foreign country every day. But it's by faith that we have to believe that God knows what is best. And he knows what is best for our life. Just want to summarise chapter 11 in various bits of faith that you see here. You see an accepting faith. Yeah? You see a recognition of God's power. Faith. You see an obedient faith, you see a responsive faith, you see a sacrificial faith, you see a courageous faith, you see a persistent faith, you see a dependent faith, you even see an obligational faith. Do you see the obligational faith? That you are obliged to God because of his faith in you. It's in Abel, in verse 4. He knew he had to give the best of himself and the best of his fruits and the best of his harvest to God because of the faith that he had in him. Do I give the best of myself to God on a daily basis? The answer will be, honestly, no. Do we really give the best, or do we give sort of the end of the day when we're exhausted? And it's all due to faith in God and knowing what God is best. That's why we give our best. That's what we should give our best for. It's because we have faith in God. Now, you all stuck your hand up. Yep. So that includes you. Abel's faith was an active faith. Faith is not passive, is it? Is it passive? Can you sit in an armchair and say, yeah, I have faith in God. No, I have faith in God. Watch TV. No? It's an active faith. It's a faith that says, yes, and I will do. It's a faith that changes us. If anybody can remember as far back, if you've been a Christian a long time, what it was prior to knowing Christ, what your lifestyle was like then, to maybe what it is now. hopefully for majority of us, it should have changed. Not because of do's and don'ts, but because we have faith in God. And we have to change our lifestyle. Turn with me, please, to James chapter 2. It's only a couple of pages on in your Bible. Verse 14 to 26, page 1214. It literally is only a few pages on. What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do. You believe there is one God. Good! Even the demons believe that and shudder. You foolish man, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? And then it carries on with about Abraham. But verse 24, you see that a person is justified by what he does and not by faith alone. And into verse 26, as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. It's an active faith. Doesn't mean we work ourselves to salvation. You can't get there by works. It has to be by faith, right at the beginning. But our faith in God should have a natural outpouring of works, should have a natural outpouring of a lifestyle change. You know, when I first came to Christ in the early 90s, I professed a faith in Jesus, and it was true. Sunday morning. The other 6.5 days of the week, me, the pub, pint, smoking, and everything else you can think of under the sun, got along very, very well, thank you very much. We had a great time. So I thought. But it's true, my lifestyle hadn't changed. It changed for Sunday morning, because I was now getting up early to come to church, rather than sleeping a hangover off, I'd walk in here with the hangover. It's true. Okay? Wasn't always like this. But it's true. And I say these things because I'm honest about where I am. Was, am, is, going to be probably in the future, because you have to be honest about it. It's no good sitting here going, oh no, I've got it all sorted on the Sunday morning, because on a Sunday morning, most of us have. It's quite easy to look sorted. But if we profess a faith in Jesus, our lifestyle has to change, and it has to change. It might have changed from prior to knowing Jesus, but it will continue to change. Abraham probably thought he'd done enough, to be honest. Left his comfort, his home, went to foreign land, dealt with various situations, and he probably thought by the time he got to Isaac, he'd done enough. But God said, no, no, go and sacrifice that promise. Okay, extra action of lifestyle change and faith. The faith that we profess demands a change. It actually demands a change in our lifestyle. If you read your Bible, you can't exclude the bits. Part of that demanding change in lifestyle is actually reading the Word of God. Because we don't know what that change is meant to be and how we're meant to change unless we read the Word of God. Yes?
Yes.
Shall I say amen?
Amen.
Do you know what amen means? Shall be so, or let it be so. So every time we recite an amen, we're going, yes, let it be so for me. Part of that lifestyle change is reading the Bible. I remember when I got baptised, my mum bought me a Bible. Might have to edit this bit, Andy. My mum bought me a Bible. I think I turned it to Genesis chapter 1. That was about as far as it got for years. So really, I just went by what I thought felt right. That's not what we're asked to do. Our faith and my profession of faith had to change because I needed to have a lifestyle change. And I was only going to learn that through teaching and through reading the Word of God for myself. The other part of the lifestyle changes that I found was when I know that God was clearly asking me to cut down on my drinking, not get drunk. Being honest, okay, everybody? Bear in mind, this is in the 90s, okay? We're now in the new century. I can sort of draw a line under all. We're in the new century. When I knew that God was asking me to do that, I found just about every excuse I could in the Bible to actually get around the situation. What was it? Eat, drink, and be merry? I think that's the most famous one, is it not? That's the best one to have. I am being merry. I'm doing exactly as the Bible says. That's not what it's stating. But I use it as an excuse. I read in there, in the Bible, what I wanted to read. I tried to fix the Bible around my lifestyle. Rather than allowing the Bible and the Word of God and my faith in Him and in His Word and believing what He says is true to fix me. As it's stated right at the beginning of that video clip, you don't fix faith. It fixes you. Just currently, I don't know if anybody's read in the news recently, I'm not going to go about it too much, but anybody read in the news recently that in Scotland, in a modern art gallery, a Bible has been left open for people to write in there if they feel excluded from the Bible? To write their lifestyle in there as they wish. I believe that's my understanding from what I've read from the news items. You could actually, there was a Bible. It's now had to, due to people writing offensive remarks, it's now been enclosed in a glass case. But the idea, apparently this artist, what she said was, the idea was that those that felt marginalised and put out, they could write themselves into the Bible. My understanding is from that, that people could write certain aspects of their lifestyle that they felt they want to continue, they could write it in. That's my understanding. Have we written some of our lifestyle into the Bible that we read just so that we can continue in it, even though clearly we know we shouldn't be doing so? Faith in God, in Jesus, changes us inside to out. Not we change the outside, the Bible, so that we can continue to live our lifestyle. We cannot fit, I did write this, I'm going to say, we cannot fit our sinful lifestyle into the Bible. If it's not meant to be there, we've got to look at it and let the faith in God to know what is best to change us. We've got to be doers of what we say. James chapter 1, verses 22 states, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says." I spent years deceiving myself, and no doubt probably deceiving myself in some areas now, and I'm just not aware of it yet. God will make me aware of it, I'm sure. I have faith that He will do. But there's one thing that the list of the those that were commended for their faith, there's one thing that they believed in all along, that God knew what was best. God did it not because He was some judgmental tyrant. He did it because He knew God. They knew what God wanted for the best for them. They were aware of that. So when God asks us to do something, to change something, says, "If you profess a faith in Me, then you have got to change. I will help you to change because I know what is best for you." The greatest promise is that actually God doesn't leave us alone. doesn't leave us hanging out to dry. It doesn't say, here you go deal with it. That's why Jesus died on the cross, was it not? It was to break that power that sin had over us, so that we can actually choose not to do something. We actually have got the ability, because of what Jesus did on the cross, and because God doesn't leave us out to hang out to dry, and because we've got the Holy Spirit living within us, we have the ability to do that. But it's by faith, and we have to believe that. And do you know the only way that actually comes about is when we want to start changing? Because we actually believe that God's promises are worth the change. We believe that God's promises are worth the change. I'm going to talk about me again, I'll go back to it. Cutting down drinking, definitely giving up the smoking. I enjoyed smoking. Did at the time. Terrible, bad for your habit. But did it. And when God was asking me to quit, and various other naggings were coming from various areas, but clearly it was God telling me to quit, I was really scared to quit. It's just one area in my life. But I had to believe that what God was trying to do for me and was to see into the future was good. Because it's not just about me, it's just so that I can then be used in his kingdom. And I was being stifled by that slightly. That was a guilt thing for me, and I was being stifled. And yet I had to believe that God's promises were worth the change, were worth the pain. And I can only do that by faith. There was no other way. When I eventually did it, and I said, okay, it's only because of you, God, I'm doing this, and I chucked it all away. I said, but you're going to have to help me. I cannot do it on my own. I'd like to praise God and thank him again because he did. He didn't leave me on my own at all. He saw me right through it all. But it's that faith in God that says you need to change. I don't want to say anything else. We'll ask this one question. If you profess a faith in Jesus Christ, are you allowing that faith to change you? And it's always for the better, if it's what God wants. Are you allowing it to change you? Just want everybody just to talk to God for a minute on their own. You don't fix faith. It fixes you. Now, I know that's not in the Bible, but sometimes it's good to remember a catch line. Useful sometimes to spark us off during the week. But this morning, there's some people that have been challenged this morning about their lifestyle. But strangely enough, you just don't feel that. You know it needs to change, but you're scared and you're not quite sure if it's possible or not, and you need to have the faith that it is possible. Now, I personally spoke about two examples. Believe you me, there are plenty of others, and some not so visual. That's you this morning. If you've been challenged and you really want prayer this morning, prayer for the faith to change. The true faith to believe that it's actually the promise that God's given you is worth the change. I'm going to ask you this morning to come forward for prayer. Make a response this morning. I've got no music to play. Don't always need that. Everybody else is going to close their eyes and stuff. And if you want to come forward for prayer, people will pray for you. There's people here from the leadership team, ministry network, and others. And we will get them up to pray. That's you. Come forward now, please. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the great example of living by faith in you. It's in that book of Hebrews. Lord, and thank you what that living by faith can produce. Mouths of lions are shut. Also, Lord, we know it brings persecution and it brings ill treatment. But Lord, when we just look at that, we want to be people who live like that. But we know that can only happen when we're living by total dependence upon you, by faith, and we're earnestly seeking you, and we're earnestly seeking to see our lifestyle change because of faith in you. Lord, in these coming weeks, help each and every one of us, maybe where we need areas pointed out that have not been clearly pointed out to us this morning. But Lord, help us to bring those to the front and to bring them to you and at your feet. And just full stop, Lord, just help us to earnestly seek your face daily. In the name of Jesus, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.